And welcome back to Let's Play Torment, Tides of Numenera. For our bonus episodes. We're going to try to see if I can find the new character was introduced in version 1.1.0. And from what I understand, you have to mess with these. I loaded a previous save, so hopefully this works. Now, we've seen this before, so I'm going to read all this. You guys can pause the video if you want. I don't know which mirror it is, but... Okay. I don't know if this does it. It's a shortcut to the labyrinth. The Spectre.
Let's go.
Wait. Empty reflection?
I'll remember that. Updated my journal.
Right, the ghost, okay.
Making a note. Making a note.
Just trying to get out of this. That's Saria. Okay. Alright, so I'm going back. Because that wasn't what we needed to do, but we could find a way, because we're supposed to come back here. Because after we do what we're supposed to do with the mirrors, will appear there in the labyrinth. Oh, it hit me.
We've been waiting, dear. Shall we continue?
Mm-hmm. Then mirror kills yourself. That could be it. You raise your hand, the tiny lens bends toward it, then flinches away with a soft whong, but not before you catch a glimpse of something small and shapeless moving inside. Is that mirror moving? Erta says, his eyes shut. Never mind, don't tell me. You turn your attention back to the mirror. So, I reached for the shivering lens. Are you afraid of me? The lens goes quite still, then tips towards you, ever so slightly, like a child peering over a cliff. Thoughts spill through that tilting glass into your mind. Your gift is immediately overwhelmed. These are not words or symbols or any language you recognize. They are aware. Aware that they are thoughts and in your head. At the moment of that realization, they awaken within your mind, reorganizing your thoughts into images that communicate what the creature in the glass is thinking. Which is a circle carved in the dust, speaking its shape without words. I need a drink. Evidently didn't help that much. And inside the glass, tendrils of thick liquid stream from the corners of the lens, coiling thread by thread into a perfect vibrating sphere. In seeing it, it sees you and smashes itself against the glass, turning it utterly black. What an odd little device, Callistes murmurs. I've never seen its like. Crack. A jagged white line appears at the upper corner of the lens, racing along the surface like a breaking wave. You blink. When you open your eyes an instant later, the lens is gone. All that remains is an empty frame. Aretas stares at you. The empty frame, then you again. It's gone. I think you freed it too hard. And yet, something has changed in your mind. You hear whispers too distant to understand. You feel a presence swelling within you, reveling in the alignment of your tides. You hear a voice speak a single word, a word that echoes across the labyrinth, calling you to it.
I'll remember that.
Okay. Quest received. So this is the quest regarding I freed something from the mirrors in the buried crossroads. Now it seems to be calling to me from inside my own mind. Search the labyrinth for the creature that escaped from the changing god's mirrors. The shapeless creature in the mirrors has somehow found its way into my mind. I don't know what it wants, or if it is a threat to me. We don't have anything about do we, characters? Okay, so we want to get to the labyrinth, so bloop.
I'm faltering. I'm hurt.
Yeah, it kind of happens when you technically kill yourself, I guess. There it is. It's an
I'll remember that.
This is the creature you freed from the changing god's mirror array. You recognize it as easily as your own breath. Glowing disks twist and fold within the shapeless mass, moving in tandem like eyes. Perhaps that's what they are. They lift, bathing you in their glow, and memory overwhelms you. You are blindfolded. You feel the rough fabric against your eyes and the frame of the lens. This creature's prison in your hands. It shakes, struggling to get free. You feel its terror, its frustration, its sorrow. Your habitual frown deepens. Even now, after everything you've done to it, the thing wants to serve you. You release the lens and push it to the top of the array with your mind. It is of no use to you now, but later, who can say? Then, the memory crumbles. The creature, your mind whispers, stares up at you with eyes like radiant, unfurling flowers. What? Blurb? It sounded like he said with blurb, says, though through some hidden mouth, is a thick, wet sound, but somehow not unfriendly. You traded one prison for another. That isn't fair. Agrees, or appears to agree. And that raises Indigo Tide a small amount. It isn't quite clear if you're understanding the intention of those sounds, or are making potentially dangerous assumptions. Oom's eyes focus on you, folding and unfolding. You hear a curious sound in the hidden reaches of the darkness above. The scratch and crackle of a flame. The flame inside you. The one that warms your heart when you hear the suffering of others. The one that urges you to sacrifice anything and everything to stop them. Oom's wide eyes momentarily turn a brilliant gold. The sound dies away. Oom stares up at you, waiting. What kind of creature are you, anyway? For a while, doesn't say anything at all. It merely looks at you. Just when you think it isn't going to respond at all, a bubble appears at the center of its shifting body, then divides into two. They merge again, split, and become three. They merge, become four. Merge, and five. Soft light wells from within each of the bubbles until they are the colors of the tides. Without warning, the bubbles launch into a whirling, spinning dance, moving too fast to track, As you watch, their glowing lines become a perfect circle, a column, a shape that hurts your eyes, a vortex. Abruptly, the five bubbles pop, and the only light in Oom's body are its luminous eyes watching you. Blurk, it says, and falls silent. Can't you tell me anything else about what you are? Blurk. It thinks, a blanket, patched and faded on dry soil. Huh. What was that sound I heard when you looked at me before? Why did your eyes change color? Flushk. Oom explains, extending a slender tendril towards your ankle. It thinks, leaves tumbled down, too many to count. Let it touch you. The tendril coils around your ankle, cool and dry. Nothing else happens. Apparently, Oom just wanted to give you a hug. Oom eventually withdraws the tendril, taps your foot, and absorbs the delicate limb back into its body with a quiet porp. You aren't a reflection, are you? Can you leave my mind with me? Tendrils tickle the silent spaces behind your eyes. Images of the people already traveling with you flash through your thoughts. Srrr. Whispers shyly at last, its eyes contracting fold by fold. It seems the creature doesn't want to join you when so many are traveling with you already. Oh, we can't even let people go in here. Oom's pale, glowing, flower-like eyes widen or unfold as you approach. Alright, we need to go back and then...
Of course.
Out of any of them... Eritus, I know exactly where he'll go. The others, not so much.
Final! Sons could give birth waiting for you. Which would be nice, actually.
Okay. So...
I'm ready.
Now I have to kill myself a third time. It's a good thing we can get there easily.
I'm hurt.
How observant. Oom replies, surging toward you. Instinctively, you blink, and it's gone. Still, you feel the pressure of its presence around you. It may be waiting for you to return to the outside world.
All right.
The impossible landscape of the labyrinth fades, and you once again feel the hard ground beneath your head, the mingled smells of the world outside your mind. Still too dizzy to open your eyes, you hear a voice. Someone is talking, and not to you. They're talking to Oom. Callistia says, "You're the device we spotted in the mirrors, aren't you?" Her jewelry tinkling. Fascinating. "Surf," Oom says quietly, shyly. "Never seen anything like you before." Tiber pauses. "No, no, I tell a lie. There was a carnival outside Arvrin Wood, but that may just have been a lass in a costume." You feel Oom's weight edging into your side, nervous about this all this attention. "Always room for a little more, I've always said," Tiber says, and nudges you with his foot. "Is the lad coming with us?" "What makes you think it's male?" "Oh, I can always tell," he says, and you can practically hear his wink. "But don't dodge the question, is he coming with us or not?" "Yes, for now anyway." The light from Oom's eyes bathes the side of your face. Grimacing, you push yourself off the ground. There it is. Is that A dry leaf whirls past and it halts, tracking it with wide-eyed interest. It was thinking of something about leaves. What do you know about Sega's glyphs? Slowly, spins in place, taking in your surroundings before it returns its gaze to you. Spell check here. Not spelling, but, yeah, grammar. Missing a word. Shurp. It says rippling as though you've dropped a pebble into it. It thinks waves bite the shore, stealing mouthfuls of sand and leaving shells in the hollows. Can I examine you? Seems to sense your interest, and it glides towards you. Its eyes expand. No, they move, drifting towards the surface of its body like coins, surfacing from the depths of a well. Like controls. Touch Oom's eyes? You touch the center of Oom's left eye. It is warm and dry, like parchment left in the sun. Well, Tiber says, eyeing you with new respect, I didn't think you'd ever do something I wouldn't do, but here we are. You barely hear him.
Making a note.
Oom's eye unfolds in glowing ripples around the path of your questing finger, like the tumblers of some biological lock, revealing a deep layer of creased tissue. You feel tugging at your mind, towards a part of Sega's cliffs you left behind. The reef of fallen worlds, the laughter of children, the cones spinning and spinning. Oh yeah, those cones way back in the beginning. I don't know why I'm losing my voice here. When I touched your eye, you made me think of the cones in the reef. Why? Mutters, looking away from you. Its eyes contract, becoming pinpricks of soft light. It thinks ripples surround the place where the stone fell. Well, I'm definitely going to go there and check those out. I know exactly where those are. Why do you want me to look at the cones in the reef again? Look, says softly. Touch eyes again. The papery cilia of eyes scratch at your fingertips, but nothing else happens. Pet You run a hand over smooth back? Says, shivering. You pat again. Gently pushes your hand away. Apparently, it's good on the petting front for now. Says, the air suddenly smells of berries? It could be berries. Okay. I have other questions. Hums to itself. I have some questions for you, Oom's eyes collapse and shrink at your question, moving to the ground. It could be deference or embarrassment. It could be anything. And yet you feel a strange focusing in your mind, as if the part of it occupied is preparing itself for your questions. In that moment, you feel the tides bending around you, tugging at you. You feel the impact your actions have made on the people you've met so far in your short life. You pass a hand over your eyes, and in that moment of brief darkness, the tides are visible as rings within rings coil around everyone and everything. What are you made of, says expansively. A long tendril protrudes from its glistening flesh and goes inwards, through the outer layer, past the eyes, into its core. Narrowing your eyes, you see what it's pointing at, a battered object with a mote of black flame at its core. Concludes, withdrawing and reabsorbing the tendril. Perception. You catch a brief glimpse of ripples around that black mote. Whatever fluid is made of seems to be emerging from there. Why do I see images and strange symbols when I scan your thoughts? Grumbles, but its eyes contract as it concentrates. You feel a flurry of motion in the back of your mind. Looks up thoughtfully as its thoughts burst over you in a swirl of images. We actually know that this raises red tide. Are we supposed to know that? A clumsy hand, it thinks, selects stones from a pile, polishing and painting them. A mosaic bridge arches over a ravine. Travelers from both sides meet in the middle. One saw a sun in the swirl of mosaics. One saw a pearl. Well, we know what this is going to do. Somehow I don't think this is supposed to be here. I think this is supposed to be removed from the text. I understand it's a metaphor, but I'm still not sure what you mean by it. Does not reply. It merely looks at you, waiting for understanding to dawn. And it does, eventually. Will never speak to you, but it wants you to understand it. Metaphor is all it has. The images are its attempt at clear communication, bridging the divide between you. Hush, says, watching your eyes. Its eyes expand. Why do I keep sensing your intent even if I don't understand you? Can you put thoughts in my mind? Mutters, probing the ground with a tendril. It feels like a half-hearted denial, but you aren't sure why you think that. You sense that it isn't lying, but that your question wasn't precise enough. Perhaps your ability to sense Oom's intentions has something to do with the way the creature rearranges your thoughts to communicate with you. Even so, it's not like asking the right question will get you an answer besides loop. Which then says cheerfully, are you sure you can't read my mind? Rook. Murmurs evasively, poking the ground and avoiding your eyes. You still seem to be asking the wrong question. Why were you in that mirror to begin with? Sk. Hisses, gazing past you. Its eyes contract to pinpricks of muted light. If I offended you, I'm sorry. Makes no further sound. You glance away, only to feel a sudden weight lying over your foot. It's one of Oom's tendrils, draped around your ankle. It is shivering. It thinks the cloth tore, but there was always more. Let hug you as long as it wants. After a handful of seconds, it releases your ankle with a slip. Its eyes widen again, unfolding and expanding to their normal radiance. I sense the tides more strongly when you're around. Why is that? Rook, says, then pauses, tapping the ground. Rook, I don't know how to pronounce this, it says again, or clarifies, and something stirs inside your mind. Ah, you did find in your mind, after all. Maybe that has more of an effect than you first thought. He thinks a ray of sunlight falls through water like an arrow, growing darker, stranger. How do you help me sense the tides again? Mook, says, and you feel a tickle in the back of your mind. I have other questions. Let's talk about our companions. Msk, says, extending a number of tendrils to flick and scratch at the ground. Sloop. Tell me what you think of Calistige. Eyes dart between the ground and you. Sloop, it says shortly. Calistige says, that hardly sounds like a glowing assessment. Her face unreadable. Not that I'm any expert. Eyes collapse and contract, but it does not respond. How do you feel about Tyvir? Says at length, tendrils waving. Tyvir says, unsure, are we? Wise lad. Most days I wouldn't trust me either. Replies, patting Tyvir's foot with a tendril. He pats him. Okay, now we can use these to get up top. Good. I chose the right one. Thought I had something to do with moving between the mirrors, that kind of thing. Okay.
I'm going.
Now before I do anything, oh, there's a Philethus thing.
I'm going.
Kosh, call me a maroon at the end of the game. So yeah, I just want to find Aretas and see... Oh, I haven't even seen... Well, I'll get over there first. I haven't asked the other characters... what they think of Oom.
Let's go.
Okay, so he should be over. Oh. Come now, I wasn't planning to hurt you. It made a little noise. Cliff's Edge, right, right. It's been so long since I've been here.
Yes.
See, Calistige knows. It has been a long and excellent journey. Really enjoy this game so much, guys. I'd say, probably my game of the year so far. Not that I've played much. It made more sounds. So it just kind of glides across. Where is he? There it is. One of the people. Tell me what you think about Oom, Calistige. It's a rather charming little device, isn't it? I'd love to dissect it, if you wouldn't mind. Oom hisses, shuddering. Not while you're alive, dear. Just at some point after you're not. Tiber.
Yes, lass.
Charming little thing, I think, and beautiful in his own way. Brrf, Oom says, vibrating. Relax, lad. It was just a compliment. Keep your trousers buckled. I don't think Oom has trousers. Okay, so... Oh, with Tiber.
Yes,
actually, yeah. Let's part... Right, he hangs out in Caravanserai. Okay, got it. I understand now. This... We can see the tides as a result of having Oom around. We can see exactly what tides go up. That's pretty cool. Actually, to tell you the truth, though, I'd prefer playing the game without it. I liked, you know, judging for myself what tides would go up. Right, this is what we said before. Raises blue tide. Alright. I still have to look at its profile and stuff. What do you think of Oom? He's one of my best friends, Aretas declares. I feel like I've known him for years. Oom says glurp. It thinks even layers of silt, soil, and stone folded around a spherical core. If that was an oath of friendship and undying loyalty, I accept. And he thinks, are we also his best friends? Absolutely not. Oh. These are the paragons and whatever inside them. The paragons and the audience. He's one of my best friends, Erita says, beaming. That's cute. Alright, so let's take a look. There is Oom's mass. Oom's body is a mass of gently undulating jelly. It uses shaped tendrils to propel itself, shaping itself to its environment. Yep, no one else can equip that. Epidermal casing. Oom has remarkable control over the permeability of its epidermis. Oom's blooped. You don't know what this is, and nothing in Oom's repertoire of imagery can explain it for you. And Oom's sploot. You think this might be some sort of receptor or converter, but you just can't be sure. It's holding a splurge. Medium range weapon. 3 physical damage, plus 1 damage per effort to a max of plus 8. Your enemies are Oom's enemies, and it will defend you. It spits a chunk of itself at your foes, regenerating the blob internally when its projectile has found its mark. Okay. It can carry 2 ciphers. Loyal guardian who flows with the tides, Oom is bonded to you with a quiet, surprising strength. He is a guardian. Whatever Oom's origin, the creature seems to regard you as its ward. It will do anything to protect you. Oom is a creature of the tides, infinitely malleable. Oom likes the last cast off. So, his abilities. Oom boosted title insight. Reveals the title effects of dialogue options. Exactly, here it is. And reactivity based on your dominant tides in conversation. With Oom's aid, you can see when people respond to your dominant tides, or when your choices will change your tides. Haptic armor. Target one ally. Short range. Oom wraps a portion of its body around an ally, offering them protection but leaving itself weakened. When in this state, Oom cannot assist on tasks in conversation or use action in crisis. Using the remove haptic armor ability returns Oom and the target to normal. So, haptic armor is plus 2 armor and resistance, plus 15% on might and speed tasks. Active until next sleep. Oom expels a piece of itself to enfold and improve its friends. Okay. So you effectively have 3 people in battle, but for this protective armor. Remove haptic armor. Unavailable. The haptic armor fettle must be active to use this ability. Oom reforms itself, returning to its normal form, removes the haptic armor fettles from Oom and the target. No action required. When finished protecting its friends, Oom reabsorbs its haptic armor. Okay. It's got healing as well. Do we have a journal entry for Oom? Oh, and a companion, not characters. Oom is an amorphous blob that you found hiding in the mirrors of the buried crossroads. Once contacted, Oom made a home in your mind. It's clearly psychically reactive, and it seems to have bonded to you. Oom, come here. Come here. Why does it only respond to you, Castoff? Alright, so...
Yes.
You know what I want to check? I don't think... Yeah. Well, it's a quest item, isn't it? The bronze sphere. Yeah, we don't have that yet. Otherwise, I could trade out Allegern and see their reactions. But I'm gonna go...
I'm going.
...to the Reef of Fallen Worlds and see what it's... has to do with those cubes. Or whatever I call them. They were cones. Yeah, cones.
Yes, now.
Intellect is 0. cones. The first really strange things we found in this game were these cones. And there's something about and the cones.
I'm going.
The cones have not stopped whirling around each other. Perhaps they never will. You see Oom's reflection in their gleaming surfaces as they dance and find you can't look away. Rorn, a voice says from the space between the cones, and your vision blurs and goes dark.
I'm ready to learn something new.
A moon hangs over you, but it is not the one you recognize. It's black, and in a pearl-white sky. Thick, flat asteroids orbit it like petals in the wind, and the air smells of scorched hair and grief. You feel cresting tendrils at your ankle, and you turn. It's cowering at your feet. It's comfort, You kneel, offering your hand to as it folds tendrils around your palm. Shaking, you close your fist around them. It seems like the right thing to do. Then you sense movement above you in the pale sky. At first glance, it seems like a hole in the air, dark as the void above. But no, bruised light pours from the hole, folding into the suggestion of a hooded figure, vast as planets. The sorrow. It is here, and it sees you. The shadow of it races across the land, a wall of black like a tidal wave. Tugs at you again, and you fall back, back, through the land itself, into light, into daylight. So, a moon hangs over you. Is that the moon that we visited in the mirror at the end of the game? With the, what's his name? The changing god trying to escape. Wavering on your feet, you open your eyes, unaware that you'd closed them. The cones continue their merry dance as if nothing had happened. You look down at Was any of that real? Or was it something you made up for me to see alone? Pluk, murmurs, tracing a long, long line on the ground with an absent tendril. It looks at you, through you. It thinks a lightless ocean trench carved into the earth. I know what that means. Its eyes are circles, but the surfaces of them are textured and bent like a page of paper folded into thousands of shapes. As you watch, a ripple spills from the center, a flower unfurling, and something unfolds in your gut, and Oom's eyes gleam.
I'll remember that.
You sense there is more Oom wants to show you, but you should finish inspecting these spinning cones first. Try speaking to them again. Childlike laughter is their only response. Okay, I tried. Touches the ground with a hesitant tendril, as if expecting it to vanish.
I'm ready to learn something new.
That's what we had to do. You lay the tips of your fingers on upturned eyes. Cilia spiral from your touch, in spinning, curling paths oddly reminiscent of the dancing of the cones in the reef. When these paths intersect, a jolt shudders up your arms, building a much-folded memory before your eyes, layer by layer. But this is not your sire's memory. No, it is Oom's, locked in those glowing eyes until you freed it. It is dizzying, nauseating, barely comprehensible. It is a memory gathered with organs you don't have, etched into the strands and folds of eyes, by grief, by agony. Distantly, your teeth dig into your lip as you concentrate, trying to translate this experience into something you understand. Squeeze eyes until the nausea subsides. Or lean for support. Lean on Oom for support. Gasping, you fall towards Oom, hands outstretched into the dizzying vortex of sensation and memory. You see the changing god in his countless bodies in an instant that spans centuries. You feel the experiments he performs to extract your secrets. Feel the wounds opening, tearing, closing, opening, tearing, closing, over and over and over. You speak. You plead. If he can hear you, he gives no sign. Not once in a millennia of torment does he acknowledge your voice. With a shout, you pull your hands from Oom, eyes streaming, choking, struggling for air. You find your breath and wipe the stinging tears from your face. Oom is looking up at you, waiting, its eyes collapsing, burying the secrets you learned beneath layer upon layer of cilia. You must be strong to have survived what the changing god put you through. With a shivering tendril, Oom traces a single, short line on the ground. Then it looks up at you, eyes flickering and folding. It thinks a sharp wind bends a branch. Groaning, it straightens, again and again. This metaphor I get. So gold and red tide raise a small amount.
I'll remember that.
It says, and a tendril wraps around your wrist, pulling your hand down, slipping between your fingers until they are spread to its satisfaction. Beneath each layer a light blooms, one for each finger, one for each tide. Drac, concludes Oom, releasing your wrist. It thinks a flying bird circles a bonfire, delighting in its heat. Its feathers smoke and curl. Huh. If the changing god was so cruel to you, why are you helping me? Rack, Oom says. Without looking at you, it traces two circles on the ground, side by side, with quick sweeps of a tendril. Why are you showing me your past? A shudder ripples through Oom's body, but it does not respond. It thinks a torch burns at the mountaintop, drawing the eyes of everything that lives in the dark. It burns not to keep the darkness at bay, but because it was lit. Oom, why are you showing me your past? It traces five interlocking circles on the ground, with a dot at their center, in gleaming liquid on the ground, but does not otherwise reply. So did it used to be one of these cones? Oom's eyes stir beneath your hands, as do the tides within you. Something is missing. You need a better understanding of the tides to see and understand what Oom is trying to show you. So in other words, it means we have to level up. So we're not going to be seeing that. It says it wants to talk again, though. That's the same. Can you tell me anything useful about the changing god? Risk, Oom says shortly, drawing a circle on the ground and another beside it. Says it wants to talk to me. Maybe if I level up. If I level up now. I'm just choosing anything because. This is not a save I'm keeping. Okay, I've leveled up. Nope. Still says it wants to talk to me, huh? Well, guys, thanks for watching. That is Oom. And there's the pack of five gum. Thanks so much for watching, guys. Sorry about that. I have actually two more bonus videos going up. One, well, they're both, what do you call it? Mirrorcasters. I missed a mirrorcaster in the Necropolis. And I missed one if we actually give Dracogen the magmatic annulet instead of the cortex. He gives us a mirrorcaster. So we have two more mirrors we can go through. So that'll be two more bonus content videos. Thanks so much for watching. See you next time, and endure. In enduring, go strong. What are you, Oom, and where can we find more of your kind? I stand corrected.